Dear Minister Zaorálek, Chancellor Schüssel, Professor Rothfeld, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to welcome you to this evening's political saloon. We're very, very happy that we have you again with us. You have been with us this morning with Minister Kurz, because this event, tonight's saloon, is embedded in a larger event which took place this afternoon at the Institute, and that is the first meeting of the Czech-Austrian Forum of Dialogue on the Political and Societal Changes of Radicalism. After this meeting, we decided to continue with a public event, which is this event, evening's discussion, chaired by my colleague Ivan Krashtev and Mr. Ulch from the Presse, who is our longtime cooperation partner on political saloons. I would like to thank both of you for being with us this evening. I would like to particularly express my gratitude to three or four people who have made this evening's event possible. Before I do that, I would like to also say a word of thanks for the IWM, which is supporting all of our political saloons. The two ambassadors, the Czech ambassador to Vienna, His Excellency Sešta, and the Austrian ambassador to the Czech Republic, His Excellency Grubmaier, have both contributed to the initiative which made the evening and the discussion this afternoon possible. We hope that this is a continuing forum. It will go from here next year to Prague, and we're very happy that we were able to house the event this afternoon. The two people who on our side who made this evening possible is Lutka Hagedorn, who is director of our Patochka archives, and it's the archives which links us very specially since many, many years, since in fact for our IWM's founding, to the Czech Republic. So this is a special event for us that you are here, Mr. Minister. And I would like to say a special word of thanks to Professor Peter Trulak, who is political secretary in the Foreign Ministry of the Czech Republic, because it was his cooperation on a day-to-day basis in realizing what was initially just an idea and bringing it to fruition in this form. So with that, I hand over to Mr. Ulch, or to Ivan Krashtev, to Mr. Ulch, and a very warm welcome to you, Mr. Minister.
Well, thank you. Good evening. I suggest, as time is tight, we start right away. You have prepared a talk for us, so I would like to give you the floor, Mr. Foreign Minister.
thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. It's really an honor for me to speak here at the Institute für die Wissenschaft von Menschen, and I have to start by thanking by the Institute for Wissenschaft for its immense contribution to intellectual exchange between our two countries. It's really, I'm speaking very frankly, that I very appreciate it. Before the collapse of the pre-war world, Czech and Austria intellectual lives were part of the same universe. The greatest Czech minds, including President Masaryk, thrived in what used to be the Central European Academic Literary and Artistic Community. I have read about Professor Franz Brentano, was a teacher of Masaryk in these years, very long time ago, and it was probably for Masaryk fascinating figure, very important for this whole development in further years. And this institute, especially, and in particular, Krzysztof Michalski and his team deserve credit for nourishing these links even during the Cold War and beyond. I have to appreciate also because we have not so many figures like Jan Patočka, because we have not so many famous philosophers. It's something extraordinary in our history, and that's why it seems to me fascinating that this cooperation started between Vienna and Prague. And for intellectuals in the former Eastern Bloc, such lifelines were essential. For as we all know, intellectual creativity dies out in isolation, and this communication and cooperation is fundamental. In short, Institut für Wissenschaft is one of the places where Central Europe truly happens and where it blends into a larger continental whole. Let me just highlight one of our common projects, the Jan Patočka Fellowship, which provides Czech researchers with a chance to partake in Institut für Wissenschaft, will mention. And many ways Patočka's philosophy makes for an inspiring point of departure in thinking about the theme of the Czech-Austrian Forum, radicalism. Radicalism is a subject of paramount interest and political relevance for both the upcoming Austrian chairmanship of the OSCE and the Czech presidency of the Committee of Ministers of the Council of Europe. It has become a commonplace to affirm that we live in a time of multiple and overlapping crises. Yet somehow we are struggling to grasp the essence of the problem, and we can sense its existential weight, as EU leaders remind us rather frequently. But we are still unable to establish the basic elements of our situation. Such crises are, of course, conducive to false prophets of all kinds who reduce our predicament to a single set of causes and propose simplistic remedies. In this context, turning to Patočka is instructive in two ways. First, his philosophical work is informed by a thorough knowledge of European history. He reminds us that crises were built into European modernity from the very start. A second, Patočka seeks to vindicate European modernity by pointing to a possible pathways for its renewal. Far from taking crises simply to signify that our means have become insufficient and our ends inconclusive, Patočka reminds us in the Husserlian vein that crisis derives from krinein, this is a Greek word for distinguish. And crises shed light on our condition and help isolate the essential from the accidental. It means that the crisis is probably also some opportunity for us, maybe to be able to understand better and to isolate the essential from the accidental. But it would be a mistake to treat Patočka's philosophy of history as nothing but a message of consolation in times of hopelessness. Erazim Kohák points us to a programmatic and deeply democratic facet of Patočka's thought. This applies in particular to Patočka's essay Super Civilization and its Internal Conflict, published in the 1950s. Patočka uses the term super civilization to describe the unique nature of European modernity. Unlike older civilizations, which were religious at heart, European modernity builds on creative impulses that are rational, enlightened, and secular. It has found its expression in the universality of science, in the capitalist world economy, in secularization. This will not strike us as particularly novel, at least those acquainted with Weber, Husserl, or Masaryk. What is inspiring, though, is Patočka's ability to discern two distinct strands in rational civilization, both unfolding from the seminal event of the French Revolution, radicalism and modernantism. The radical strand is marked by total adherence to rational organizational principles an obsession with transforming societies to the point of suppressing anything outside of this remit. On the other hand, moderantism, as Patočka calls it, retains an awareness of the limitations in rationalist modernity. It has no ambition to encompass the totality of life. It mobilizes the forces of reason for means rather than ends. This liberal form of modernity derived from the transformative idea of individual freedom. It leaves room for the heterogeneity of human interests and for diverse social orders. When Patočka wrote his essay, both the radical and moderate strands found their imperfect embodiment, the first in the Soviet Union, the second one in the West. As Patočka points out, however, these were but historical instances of wider trends. The threat of radicalism is virtually inseparable from modernity in following its inherent principle. Rational civilization is inclined toward radicalism, towards extinguish diversity. Maybe we can really follow something similar, this tendency to something like flat civilization. And what remains of this analysis 60 years on? Soviet radicalism imploded. Unfortunately, its collapse did not reinvigorate Europe's moderate rational civilization. Rather, it gave way to its gradual erosion. The political crisis of today is the culmination of this process. The ultimate institutional expression of this civilization, the European Union, is under attack from radicals of all stripes. Patočka vindicates radicalism on one score in its moral intuition. Radicalism points its finger at intolerable injustice. In eradicating injustice, radicalism is ready to spare no means. However, in the end, the radical gesture is self-defeating. It is heroic, rightfully enraged, yet its restlessness makes it negligent to historical constellations, prone to violence, and conducive to producing either ever more injustice or more paralysis. In this sense, the rage that propels today European radicals can be seen as legitimate. There is a real social injustice in our societies, in part thanks to the way the Eurozone is governed. The alienation from EU integration is undeniable. The anger over social inequality is genuine and indeed morally justified. Today's radical and anti-European parties are not just a product of Russian intrigue. They channel real insecurities over globalization, immigration, or galloping technological change. We all know that radicals have no real solutions. In some countries, such as the United Kingdom, their lack of responsibility is becoming patently obvious. But that's not enough. It's not enough to dismiss the anti-European backlash as misguided and sinister. If European modernity is to survive, it must overcome its present condition. Unfortunately, the original manifestation of moderate rational civilization, political liberalism, is now reduced to economic liberalism instead of upholding social dignity and political cohesion, it breeds selfishness and atomization. Instead of promoting the plurality of social choices, it has degenerated into a technocratic system of governance where radicalism is the only alternative to status quo. This is a cycle identified by Patočka. without tolerance for diversity, without social cohesion, without democratic accountability, modernity feeds radicalism. To escape this trap, our civilization, our politics, and our institutions must reinvent their primary function. In the language of Patočka, they must produce durable public assets capable of being universally human. In other words, they must generate truth, means, and values that are independent of the interests of particular social classes or privileged groups. It requires a political and social system capable of integrating all those who happen to languish or to suffer in need on its internal and external periphery. Patočka's philosophy does not contain a checklist of institutional solutions, and we should be suspicious of everyone who pretends to have them. However, his writings provides us with a key political insight. If we are to survive the onslaught of radicalism, pure rationality will not suffice. It seems to me interesting. Patočka's conception of moderation is not the same as technocratic or managerial governance. Yes, in fact, it is no right solution. It is the very opposite. It requires a positive and substantive vision of politics. Maybe now I'm saying not too much, but it's difficult to say more. Patočka's moderate civilization is our shared European heritage. It seems to me fundamental. Something of this is really fundamental of our culture. The European Union is its greatest political and institutional achievement, and only framework in which the spirit of moderation can be redeemed. And I'm convinced, really, like practic politician, that really this moderate culture of European institution, which was created after Second World War, is really something which is only chance for us as small nations here in Central and East Europe. And maybe I am able to make step to practical politics, and I can say that, for example, in this respect, the Bratislava summit last may count as real step forward, but it will be a long journey and there is no shortcuts. Our countries bear a special responsibility to contribute to Europe's renewal, which means, first and foremost, standing up to the tide of radicalism in our own countries. It has maybe a different form, but something is in common in this different phases of radicalism in our countries. Unfortunately, the political discourse in Central Europe has become tainted by anti-liberal and nationalist elements. We hear calls for a cultural counter-revolution. It was in Krynica, probably, where it was pronounced. We hear proposals for radical change to the EU's institutional order, in effect, reverting European cooperation to the pre-Maastricht era and others. They are flawed and these are flawed and dangerous ideas. It is exactly the kind of destructive radicalism that Patočka warned against. On the other hand, we should also acknowledge that the backlash against modernity is not a uniquely Central European phenomenon. It affects most of the developed world. Its sources run far deeper and wider than communism or the legacy of post-communist transformation. We must also acknowledge that it is not representative of the prevailing attitudes in our own societies. A distinction must be made, and is not made often enough, between popular anxieties over uncontrolled migration and attitudes toward the European project. We may find, as Ivan Krastev highlighted in one of his recent pieces, that our societies are more supportive of EU integration than some older member states. I'm not speaking maybe about Czech Republic, but we are speaking about Poland or Hungary, maybe in this case. It was true from your side. Today it is fashionable to speak of new geographical division in Europe in which our region is cast as a source of revolt against liberalism and EU integration. The dichotomy is, it is as simplistic as it is dangerous. And all the time I am trying to face this simplicity. The story is much more nuanced. I am reminded of the work of Karl Markus Gauss, the Austrian novelist and a great student of the Central European milieu. He wrote of our Hassliebe with Western Europe, an ambiguous relationship that accounts for the unique role of Central Europe in the continent's history. There was always a degree of condescension in Western perception of Central Europe. The stereotype had the fortunate effect of stimulating our own curiosity and ingenuity. Our region rarely spawned any meta-ideas that would transform the course of history. This remained the domain of the West. But it was here that many vanguard ideas were put to a test. The region's sprawling intellectual life provided fertile ground for such political experiments. But not all were successful. Consider, for instance, cosmopolitanism. It required a number of attempts until the idea took hold in our context, and only partially, despite its cultural and ethnic diversity and despite its experience with totalitarian regimes. Central Europe never fully embraced the notion of melting pot as a cultural component of EU integration. In our region, ideas of cosmopolitanism and European unity came in more humble shape. Jiří Dienstbier, a dissident and former Czechoslovak foreign minister, wrote of dreams of Europe in the late 1980s. It may sound self-depreciating or even sarcastic, but it is neither. Our dreaming of Europe turned out to be a very productive exercise. After all, who would have thought back in the 1980s that Europe's Cold War divisions would be over before the end of the 20th century? However, for our dream of Europe to become reality, it was never enough to simply wait for a miracle. Geopolitical conditions had to be right, and it also required a smart strategy. This is where we come back to Patočka's dichotomy between moderation and radicalism. In political practice, they correspond to strategies as evolution on the one hand and revolution on the other. Central Europe's political culture is one of the pragmatism and restraint. It also had its fair share of revolutionary fervor. Just recall 1848, 1948, 1968 in Austria and Germany, and of course 1989. The post-1989 period also witnessed a number of protests in which civil society mobilized against political elites. By and large, however, their success was limited. Lofty ideas rarely survived day-to-day implementation. More importantly, as is clear from modern Central European history, and as Patočka understood very well, radical departures are often self-defeating. Revolutions end up delegitimizing their own protagonists and disrupting legal continuity. More often than not, they lead to frustration and pessimism and undermine any prospect for meaningful change. Progress in Central Europe typically unfolded in an evolutionary form through diligent and patient work to improve the state of public affairs. The advantage of evolutionary progress is that it must be a continuous process, unconstrained by time, so it is never too late to start. And of course, it tends to be an inclusive and open endeavor. We must remain true to these traits of Central Europe. Rarely in history has it been more important than today. The discourse in the European Union, especially after Brexit, is rife with radical ideas and sirens of counter-revolution. We must resist them. Our common task now is to reclaim the ideals of moderation and in inclusive progress. In other words, to reclaim the foundations of European modernity as Patočka understood it. This is how I envision the role and the responsibility of our two countries to preserve Central Europe as a political space of openness and tolerance. From this perspective, the significance of Czech-Austrian relations goes far beyond a standard diplomatic agenda of two neighbors and EU partners. For me, it is also a deeply personal relationship, not least thanks to the intellectual connections facilitated by the work of the Institute for Wissenschaft. We have a solid foundation to build on. During my time as foreign minister, Czech-Austrian relations have undergone something of a renaissance, maybe I can use this word. The scope of our cooperation is expanding. It includes a broad range of areas from north-south energy and infrastructure linkages to EU enlargement policy in the Western Balkans. There has also been a qualitative shift in our partnership marked by deeper understanding and, I hope, mutual trust also. On the many key questions on the EU's agenda, from the migration crisis to economic governance, Czech Republic and Austria share similar views. What is perhaps even more important and symptomatic of our mutual trust and respect is that no issue, however sensitive or controversial, is excluded from the conversation. There were periods in the recent past when our relations were plagued by miscommunication and some blockages and gestures. Maybe I can say that we have closed this chapter, and which does not mean that our government will always agree. Rather, it means that whatever problems may arise, they will be discussed with openness and goodwill. Today, we have added another layer to Czech-Austrian dialogue by establishing this discussion forum, and I'm very glad that I am here. And going forward, we must invest further in bilateral and regional cooperation, notably through the Austerlitz format. The platform has gained new meaning and importance in light of the present situation when politics of moderation and tolerance seem to be on the defensive. Let me therefore conclude by stressing that we now have a common political project, protecting maybe the soul of Central Europe. It's hardly an overstatement to say that our success or failure will shape the future of the EU as a whole. Thank you for your patience with my...
Well, thank you, Mr. Minister, for sharing your intellectually rich thoughts with us. It was somehow a true Patočka lecture you gave to us. But if you may allow, I would like to in the discussion, try to make a few things a little bit more concrete. You started out by saying, by formulating something which is many people are aware of these days, that it's hard to understand and hard to grasp what is really going on after Brexit, after the election of Trump, and so on. And I would like to come back to your thoughts and ask you, what are, in your opinion, the driving forces of this era of insecurity, maybe, of this rise of populist movements these days? So what are the main factors for that?
That we are losing confidence, maybe between states. We are losing confidence also in individual states, because that is, we see also growing gap in individual states between political elites and political establishment. Maybe what we are facing now in Czech Republic, to be concrete, is a new movement, yes, movement of Andrej Babiš. And that is something which is absolutely out of our common, our usual habits, usual fight between ideological fight between left and the right, because we long time we had opportunity to fight against Václav Klaus and Topolánek and Nečas, really right-wing politicians. Now we have something absolutely different in Czech Republic on our political stage, something like quickly moving target, somebody who can be characterized mainly as anti-establishment movement, and maybe it's something absolutely new, and we have maybe we are now we feel obliged to elaborate and develop new tools and maybe new ways how to face this new phenomenon. And but this movement are using this confidence gap, maybe which was created during last years. And, maybe everybody knows why this gap was created, because we were maybe many things happened during last years, and an economical and financial crisis which started in 2008. Now this foreign affairs crisis on the east and maybe in North Africa, and now migration crisis, and all these crises and combination and interlinkage between these crises maybe created new burden for Europe. Europe was not equipped. Maybe we see insufficiency, inability to react on this new situation. And that is why people are losing confidence to political elites. It's the right time maybe to start with the anti-establishment movement and show people these old politicians are unable to solve your issues, and we are ready to change everything. And a new radicalism is on the run. That's maybe very plain, but it is maybe my, and what we need now, maybe to restore this confidence. We have to find way how to restore this confidence between people and politicians.
Any ideas for that? Maybe that's the $1 million question, but how can
maybe
you restore confidence?
Oh, a few minutes ago, I had opportunity to speak with Mr. Heupel, maybe this old fighter here in Vienna, and maybe we spoke very similar issues. He told me that, yes, we have to find these concrete points and concrete places when we can show that we are able to make something for the people. And we can't avoid these concrete examples when we can show that we are effective and we can help to solve something which we feel in the air is a concrete problem, which is the burden for people. And we have to show that we are effective and that we are functioning and we are honest.
Liban, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'm very happy because there was a tradition that East European politicians used to have read something which is not tweet. And from this point of view, having a minister speaking about Patochka was very much about the tradition of the place. But also, I do believe what is very interesting for me, the very distinction between radicalism and moderation, if it comes as a major distinction, we're already talking revolutionary situation. Mm-hmm. Because it's not a distinction that is going to come to you in a time of a normal politics. And here's my three questions, because if you compare the radicalism, which Patochka and historically we know, it used to be super intellectual. Radicals used to be professors. They're staying some there, they have their theories, and they try to change the world. Now you have a very anti-intellectual type of radicalism, which is very strong on the fact that it's very inconsistent, but it managed to compensate inconsistency with intensity. It's much more the radicalism of expression than the radicalism of the projects. Because the interesting story about new radicals is that when they want power, you don't know what they'll do. My second question is how this has to do also something with technology. Because if you see this kind of love for disruption and saying, listen, let's disrupt what we have now, and something new is going to come and probably is going to be beautiful, this comes very much with the meaning of the IT people. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking Silicon Valley, really interesting people. Disruption as a kind of a go in itself. You're not interested what's going to happen tomorrow, but the basic story is, because from this point of view, how to react, and I'm very much interested in this, my question on the problem of moderation, because here's my major kind of problem. Normally, moderation was associated with the middle classes. Mm-hmm. the middle classes used to be moderate, and basically the upper classes, for different reasons, can decide to get radical, and you can expect this. Now you see a very interesting type of radicalism coming exactly from the middle classes. If you see some of the voters' profiles of the new radical voters, it's neither the poorest nor basically the richest. Why the middle class starts to get radicalized, and why this radicalism is, in a strange way, radicalism without a project? This is what interests me, and I do believe it very much goes with trying to.
Maybe I have tendency to return to this old term from the 60s, alienation. Maybe that is, maybe also this new world of technologies and IT, maybe is also producing some kind of alienation and atomization of the society. And maybe it's not so important how deep are and how deep are in need maybe these people, but maybe also this middle class representatives has feeling of maybe not frustration, but they have no perspective. And maybe this psychological feeling is maybe much more important than the concrete level of poor. So that's why. But you are absolutely right that now for radicalism we need no new great ideologist. Maybe it's different situation. It's maybe you need maybe only a few PR agencies maybe and to start to be new maybe strong radical. Yes, but we are living in the world which is changing. We can't probably fight this old fight of the past, and it's maybe this new maybe and this Czech populism and Czech anti-establishment movement is really new phenomenon. And we have to be able to develop tools how to face maybe this new type of threat. Because I'm convinced that the real threat, maybe it's my personal deep feeling that if we'll maybe in 1 year, maybe we will have new government and the new prime minister will start to run our state like a firm, it could be absolutely new situation maybe in our history, and it could produce something absolutely and different type of society. And I don't know, maybe we need this experience, but I feel obliged maybe to make what I can, maybe to correct and to correct this, maybe also maybe and to change this situation. But it seems to me that, but it's not Czech specificum. Maybe what seems interesting that we are facing very similar situation in many other countries, and we are facing similar new radicalism without big ideologies, and it's maybe test of our time, and maybe I really don't know the responses and answers on all questions, but I can imagine that this new world of technologies and ITs maybe is helping to create this new type of radicalism, but we have to elaborate these new tools how to face it. In opposite, we can face something like unfolding societies and maybe political stages will fall apart. You can imagine what could happen if, for example, Marine Le Pen will be the president of France during the next year. I can't imagine cooperation between, for example, Angela Merkel and Marine Le Pen in common Europe. And maybe it could start the process of unfolding the whole year. Maybe all these things, all these bad scenarios are possible. And I only feel that maybe maybe it's our concrete task maybe to keep together. And I see this Patočka works as maybe good source of maybe of conviction that maybe this. It's difficult because on the other hand maybe I it would be a little bit risky to feel like a representant of the all good maybe here, because I know that this old establishment is really problematic in many ways, maybe in many countries, also in my country. I know that also my Social Democratic Party has also some faults maybe and imperfections, that we have to face this tendency and we have to mobilize, because maybe nobody is perfect. Also our old parties are not perfect, and we are maybe protecting Maybe this fight in US, maybe between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, is a very good example how it looks like, this new fight. Because I am afraid that Hillary Clinton was really not good equipped for this fight against Donald Trump. And I feel very sorry about it because Hillary with all this whole story and this problem with this Clinton clan and so and many other things, it was something really which could be very dangerous in our because it is a problem of credibility. If I am declaring that I am ready to face these new threats, I have to convince people that these old threats are not similarly dangerous as this new threat. That's why. But on the other hand, I'm convinced that the situation is very serious, because for a country like Czech Republic, it's very important to keep, for example, its European project in to continue. And because I'm really afraid that in opposite, if in Europe we will start with an absolutely different movement, and maybe Europe will fall apart to many poles and different powers with different interests, I can imagine we can return to somewhere to 30s, the next century, and we remember how depressive and how difficult situation it was for Czechs in maybe this. And maybe we have to do what we can not to accept these tendencies. That's, I very appreciate this post-war project, the European project, as very important and very serious attempt to hinder, not to let this history, this history get back. And maybe I feel obliged to continue this.
I just want to add, because I do believe here Central Europe has something particular to offer to this European discussion. Because unlike West Europeans, we have only one advantage. We know how fragile any political project is. Being somebody in Bulgaria in 1989, believe me, it was not Poland, it was not the Czech Republic. Communism was as solid as nature. And overnight, it collapsed. So from this point of view, I do believe that European project is taken so much for granted. Many people believe that it is so unthinkable, the project you start to disintegrate, that this is a kind of a part of the problem itself. Mm-hmm. Because from this point of view, how to have a discussion about all these threats, at the same time not pushing these threats and not creating a self-fulfilling prophecies, in my view, is very important, because my feeling is that if something bad is going to happen to the EU, it's not going to be the revolution of the anti-EU forces against the pro-European forces. It's going to be like a run on a bank, because people start to fear that something bad can happen. Then the governments are starting to hedge against European policies to be sure that if something bad is going to happen, they're basically going to have some of their money out. And as a result of it, you're going to end up with a paralyzed European Union, at the end of which nobody is going to be ready to defend. And from this point of view, it's quite interesting, because what is, in my view, most dangerous about this new radicalism is it's a radicalism which is not asking for sacrifice. All previous radicalism was asking people to sacrifice. Nationalists, communists, everybody. Here, basically, this is a radicalism of enjoy yourself. Be who you are. And from this point of view, it's very attractive, particularly for the consumer-minded generations, for which being yourself and not trying to improve and not trying to change, this is why I was trying to see, we should be very clear what is new about this radicalism, if they're going to be an effective response.
Yes, that's absolutely right. What's the only possibility? I believe that it has sense to speak rationally with people, and that what is at stake if you have credibility to explain this to people and convince them that it's unrealistic, maybe this philosophy it is a concrete task for politicians to convince people that what is most dangerous if we will have enough credibility to explain people what is realistic and what not, and if these people are good representatives of their interest, and so that's maybe fight we will face. But yes, I feel sorry, I am convinced that we are on the crossroad. I can imagine also these bad scenarios, and but history is open. Probably we have no guarantees. Maybe Jean-Paul Sartre maybe repeated many times this. I believe that Sartre was right. We have no guarantees for the future. We have to lead this fight and convince people that it's unrealistic. Also, this philosophy, enjoy, maybe, and so.
Well, let me come back to one point. Ivan said that these are, you seem to have a similar idea, that these are radicals without any project. This seems somehow peculiar to me, because in history, radicals used to have a pretty clear and pure idea what they want. Be it the communists you have mentioned, they wanted to create a pure and ideal communist world. If you look at radical Islamists, they say Islam is the solution, so they have also a clear view of things. But the radicals you are talking about, and I'm not so sure what you mean by radicals, maybe you could also just give us some names of who you're thinking about.
But not names of prime ministers.
about thinking about. But what is the idea of those new radicals? Maybe we don't look close enough to what they want. Maybe it's not an utopia they strive for. Maybe it's some sort of, they want to turn back time and recreate the world that has changed in the last 3 decades or so.
Maybe to speaking about Czech radicalisms, yes. Maybe it seems to me that there is no big ideological project behind this, and maybe because I have opportunity to speak with our Minister of Finance very often, I know that he is convinced that all these democratic procedures are too slow and maybe too rigid, and we have too many discussions all around. It is not the must to lead similar discussions. We can limit our system also maybe to stop or to delete Senate. Maybe we can elaborate some control for our deputies to punish them if they are not working in parliament regularly. And we can develop many similar, maybe, things which will make things easier. Maybe he's playing this game with this unpopular political class only. And I see no clear vision, maybe. And this radicalism seems to me anti-democratic. Yesterday, I had opportunities to speak with Mr. Babiš, and I used maybe one argument when maybe When I said that his movement voted in government, voted for some law and for some proposal, but he told me, "Yes, movement. What is it?" Do you understand? He's convinced that he needs no similar party and movement as a party. This was his decision.
But
now today I am changing this decision. Everything is changing, maybe, because this movement is not so important. Maybe that is, if you understand, it is some type of radicalism. That is really something which is really destroying all our complicated and intricate culture of democracy and all this dispute and discussions and so. It is maybe what Patočka is thinking when he spoke about this moderantism. Yes, it is all this complicated long process of discussions which is probably precondition and prerequisite for democratic government. It is part of our life and style and atmosphere. I can imagine that all this could change. Maybe, as Patočka said, maybe that this technocratic world has maybe very dangerous tendency to be very flat in some time. Maybe we have some. There is something we have to protect all the time. Maybe every day. Maybe then, in some time, we can see absolutely different world all around. But and maybe, and this radicalism, it seems maybe a little bit nonsensical, maybe and a little bit ridiculous. but because it's maybe for what is dangerous really that for people maybe nothing is what is at stake. Maybe it's not so. We can make attempt. Maybe this man could change something. We don't. Maybe is it possible to run a state like a firm? Maybe we can make attempt to use it and maybe to try something. Mm. But I am convinced that it is something which could really change our life in very radical way. That's why I'm speaking about radicalism. It is something like. Very takový nenápadný radikalism, nenápadný.
But on the other hand, radicals without any
ambiguous.
Radicals without any clue or idea of what they want to do, they could be pretty soon be demystified when they are being brought to power.
Maybe it's one possible scenario. Mm. Maybe Marine Le Pen could be the winner of this election in France. And maybe in a few years, maybe in front, they will know that it's no solution and no. But probably it's very risky attempt because, as I said, I can't imagine cooperation between France and Germany. And this period could be a very important period for European Union. And we can see during this period the EU will fall apart, maybe and maybe to lose the position in current global world. And I'm convinced that, especially in our world, we need EU as somebody who will push some values and policies, and to lose Europe on world political scene, it could be fundamental for the whole world. Maybe we can lose something fundamental. We can lose pace, maybe, but it could be crucial for us.
The mantra of the European Union in times of crisis has become. To try more Europe, it has been some sort of a standard phrase, but people don't seem to be enthusiastic about it. Do you think that this is a clever idea and approach to solve this problem?
To speak about more Europe, it means probably to strengthen European institutions and so. But I am afraid it's not time for. European, and it's not time for discussion about institution. It's not time to change treaties, for example, to strengthen European institution, because I'm afraid that we are not able to create consensus. And maybe we know, everybody knew how it was with the Lisbon Treaty and with voting about constitutional treaty. It seems to me it's not right time for strengthening institution. It's time to deliver something concrete to people. And that's why I would like not... I prefer not to speak about more Europe, but to be able to deliver something concrete in these days. Maybe concrete in security, concrete in an economy, concrete in transparency of our policy.
So what to go to this, because listen, I'm Bulgarian. We're famous for one thing. In Bulgaria, it's easier to resurrect than to be re-elected. For 25 years, only once the governing party won the elections, and even then they didn't allow them to make a government. Why I'm saying this? Because part of this radicalism comes from the fact that now you can have a low-cost radicalism. And paradoxically, European Union gives incentives for this. If you're Bulgarian, how you think? You don't like what you see, for good reasons. What you say, the establishment is not inspiring. You want change. And you said, nevertheless, for whom I'm going to vote, even if I have a radical vote, European Union is a guarantee that nothing really bad is going to happen. This is the same idea with the safety valves. Basically, you have this type of a protection mechanisms which allows you to play radical. Mm-hmm. So from this point of view, I like to talk that our societies are very fearful. To be honest, I'm not buying this. Fearful people are very careful people. Our societies are anxious. Which is different. Fearful people, he knows what he fears. He's basically thinking in terms of threat. Mm-hmm. While you have a very kind of a loud talk, but you don't see a real fear. Mm-hmm. This is what I do believe is quite interesting, to what extent European Union is not becoming the victim not of its failures, but of success. You start to create and to succeed to create a society which feels so secure. That as a result of it, the idea of a really dangerous development is not perceived anymore, is real. And you can experiment. You can vote for anybody you want. I was very much interested, for example, why the dismantling of check and balances system, I mean, independent banks and court system and so on, why people are not so much worried. Mm-hmm. In my view, for two reasons. One is that basically you have Brussels. Even people who don't like Brussels said it's a form of control. Mm-hmm. But the other is, if you see from the point of view of the people on the street, the separation of power is not the way to control the elite, but to give a different excuses for the elites that they are not doing what they have promised to do. Basically, the government said, listen, I wanted to do it, but the court didn't allow me. This didn't allow me. And then you said, let's give them more power in order to keep them accountable. So paradoxically, the major liberal idea of accountability through separation of powers, going through this very idea, is that if somebody does not have enough power, you cannot keep him accountable, because basically he does not have enough power to deliver. And for me, this is an interesting story, because all this economic explanation that everything is economy, Poland didn't have economic crisis, and to be honest, the Czech Republic. Mm-hmm. What I can understand for Hungary, Poland is a different story. People talk about social inequality. By the way, in the last 5 years, the Gini coefficient in Poland went down. Social inequality has been declining. So it's not only about inequality. Obviously, there is some zeitgeist, there is something about the atmosphere, there is understanding, and I do believe we should go on this, because when you say we should deliver something very real, the problem is to whom? Because the most vulnerable groups are not the most radical groups. And it's not easy to deliver to people who have something. Listen, the middle classes, some of them who are now part of the radicals, they're not the persons that you can buy with a social program. Mm-hmm. And I find this is, and because you're seeing this is a practical issue, you know, I'm very much interested.
Yeah, I agree. Things are much more complicated. And that I agree that this good soil and terrain for radicalism is maybe in countries which are successful. For example, US are a good example, because now maybe the last months and years in the US were relatively successful on also the way how they managed economy and financial crisis. And it seems that maybe when society is really declining, maybe that people could be afraid of radicalism. Yeah. But maybe relatively stable development could be very good soil terrain for radicalism. I agree. Things are not so easy to understand.
Yeah, so. I think we should open the floor. But just one remark. Ferit Zakaria wrote an interesting piece on populism the other day. And he made an interesting observation that there is no thing like populism in East Asia, in countries. Well, maybe with the exception of Duterte. But
Thailand?
but in dynamic India, societies, yeah. There is no thing like populism. So maybe
India, yeah.
India would be a great counter example to Farid Zakaria. I'm sorry.
Uh-huh. Okay, well, we start the discussion already with the audience. So if you, we have a few more minutes. If I get you right, the minister has to leave then. But maybe we can take two or three questions, please. Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you. Mr. Minister, just one question. Probably we need more radicalism, official radicalism also, in order to satisfy people. And one possibility would be to provide the member states with more responsibility in regaining momentum for the European integration. Actually, that sounds very flat, but it is actually a lot when we want to work together in this area. For instance, in taking certain things which you can read in the treaty as shared competences between the European Union and the member states, that in reaching the goal of European integration, and that the member states take more ownership again in, for instance, taking up certain things in small groups, in interest groups within the European Union. For instance, by enacting a good neighborhood policy, which is which is something which you yourself feel responsible for. Is that a kind of radicalism which could be a message to the people?
Yes.
Maybe take a second one. Yeah. Please keep it short, Mr.
Rothfeld. First of all, I would like to thank you very much for this much deeper approach and an attempt to explain what is in fact behind, I would say, something what is seen by many as very chaotic and not understandable. But having said that, I would like to say that, in my view, there are some elements which is very difficult to explain for the reason that they are irrational. Because what you said and what Patočka analyzed, it is, I would say, a kind of the system which could be presented as rational. The problem is that emotions are irrational. Having said that, my intention is to say that the Czech Republic and Slovakia, it is not very typical place, because I would say even before the war, after the First World War, the Czechoslovakia was the only country in the Central Eastern Europe with a genuine, real democracy. All the others, they did not have the experience of democracy. But the problem is not only in that, because we have the same process, for example, at the moment in Spain, Catalonia, Basque land, in United Kingdom with Scotland, Corsica. I can prolong, I would say, even Belgium with Flemish people and Valons. Altogether, I would like to say that one element is national identity. It is very important element which has to be taken in very serious way by the European Union and by the European states in general. This is not only the problem of Hungary, Poland, it is the problem of many other countries in Europe, I would say even probably for all the countries. And now my question to you is whether all our experience, because for the first time Europe for 75 years, in recent more than 400 years, was in fact, it was the longest period in the history of Europe. I'm not speaking about the periphery of Europe, south. I have in mind, first of all, Yugoslavia, and to some extent what is going on the border between Russia and Ukraine. But the Central Europe and the rest of Europe, Western Europe, for the first time, 75 years in peace. Now the question is, what has to be done in order to prolong that with all the problems? In other words, you rightly said that it cannot be compared to corporation, to the way of running the country, the international community in a way which is not adequate to the relations between states. My suggestion, I would like to ask you whether you are the same opinion, namely, problems are for the first time generated, if not only, then mainly within the states. And the whole system is oriented, addressed, designed to resolve the problem between the states. The question for international community is to find the way that internal problems, domestic problems, will be legitimate subject for the international community to find the solution.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So, the first question was about the lack of official radicalism.
Yes, but I agree with Mr. Trautmann-Dorff that maybe we need this radicalism, maybe to on the level of shared responsibility between countries, between neighbors and so. And I very appreciate his contribution to this during his stay in Czech Republic, because I'm convinced that you pushed us all the time maybe to keep this cooperation between neighbors and to maybe to react, for example, on migration crisis and to be radical in sharing responsibility in this. And I can only say that you are absolutely right. This type of radicalism, maybe something like democratic radicalism, I support and I agree with you absolutely. Maybe it is the right response on this false radicalism which we are speaking about in this day. And but maybe in this I agree with you that we need some sort of radicalism also in and it is maybe part of our task. Maybe I absolutely agree. And maybe this very very difficult question how to prolong this 75 years of peace, if I'm right. I really don't know if I know this right answer, but it seems to me that it is a responsibility of us as politicians maybe to be able to return this confidence between people in our individual countries and at the same time between countries in Europe. Maybe to be short, I can only tell you that it is what I see as the tool for politicians. We are building confidence between people. And I feel obliged to speak with people in the streets and in squares. And maybe when we are making political campaigns, it's not only about victory, it's about communication also. Because repeatedly we have to go through the whole country and to speak with people, and maybe what we are collecting is we are collecting confidence. And maybe it's not only maybe to win or to be defeated, but it is maybe to create community. Because the discussion of politician with people is something which is creating some atmosphere and community. And the question if we will be able to create this community and to have support and to have this credibility, and then maybe we are able to keep our societies stable. And in opposite, maybe it's and as Sartre said, we have no guarantee for the future. Maybe if we will be not be able to work enough, maybe we can lose this, and we will be not able to create this confidence, and we can see our political systems fall apart, and also maybe we can see that also this all European system could fall apart. And you are right that situation is dangerous, because if you are asking for if we are able to prolong this, maybe we are speaking maybe that maybe we have not enough energy and maybe to manage this. And you are right that it's a dangerous situation, but when I would be time to speak about current atmosphere between in European Union institutions, it's clear that situation is really very nervous, yes. And maybe atmosphere during this is also very nervous. Maybe this last meeting which we had maybe a few days ago after this Donald Trump victory, it was very interesting session, because the main topic was if it was right idea to convene this gathering, because maybe this feeling that emergency summit is maybe showing that we are nervous maybe, and so, and the main topic was maybe, and maybe we split it to two parts. One was convinced that it was no right idea to convene all, and this, the second part maybe said, Federica, you are right, because it was very important
and
to meet.
And useless, right?
But yeah, so, I'm only maybe that it's clear that probably what we are facing now is something extraordinary, and it's really crossroad, as I said, and we have to show that we are able to manage this and to handle also this situation. But I'm positive, because I'm convinced that if we'll be able to overcome this crisis, then maybe we can chance also to prolong this this peace. Maybe in opposite, I said it today sometime that Tomáš Garrigue Masaryk said in some book that most dangerous thing in Europe is if countries are splitting to different poles, and if different powers in Europe will start play different games, maybe. And that's maybe for me personally, I'm convinced that I know what is the right part or path, how to face it. But the question, it will be strong enough, and it's open.
I'm afraid the minister has to catch a plane, but maybe we could take one more question, if that's all right with you. The lady in the fourth row, please.
Thank you very much, Anna Donova, Vienna Institute for Advanced Studies. You made the last comment you made me think about also what we discussed this afternoon in the first dialogue, which is that we tend to present radicalism, and we've been discussing about the sources, as a middle-class phenomenon, as something coming from out of the people. And somehow we left that already for the people because we somehow forget our part. And it's actually a very bad coincidence that Wolfgang Schüssel just left, because I was going to make this comment that in 1999, when the new government in Austria was being negotiated, the 14 EU countries were sanctioning Austria because FPÖ was coming to government. I don't think that something of that kind could happen in 2016 in France or in Hungary or even in Austria. So what is changing is not only the people's mood, but also the mood of political establishment. So what are we going to do about that?
Can I make a joke?
Yes.
Yeah.
The risk is totally different, that in some years you're going to have sanctioning of liberal governments coming to power.
No, probably sanctions are not the tool how to change situation in Europe, maybe. And I know that Miloš Zeman was in this time was prime minister, maybe, and he was only prime minister out of European Union who accepted maybe and to join to this sanction. And we spoke about today with my ambassador and. We know now that Miloš Zeman now has opinion that it was mistaken in this. Maybe that today that is not time to repeat similar gesture. That's why only he maybe is convinced that it's impossible to use this tool again. Maybe it would be enough probably, but I hope that in France we will be different president. Maybe it's my. I hope also maybe that in Austria we will have maybe. Different, but it's only my wish. Maybe I would like to finish with this frank and deep wish, because maybe I can say not to intervene to your it's the result of this election could be very important for Austria in similar way as the result of this France election will be important for France, and not only for you but for all of us. Apologize for this intervention and thank you for your patience and interesting discussion.
Well, thank you for your time. Thank you.